Well, welcome everyone today to Abolition Requires We Change One Thing, Everything. That was Lil Baby singing The Bigger Picture. I wanted to welcome everyone, and we just want to let everyone know that this meeting is being recorded, and it's going to be live streamed on Facebook as well. So if you're not comfortable being recorded, you can turn off your video and you can delete your name if you would like. You can change your name by right-clicking on your photo and your name as well. We are recording now. We'll be starting the Facebook Live now also. Welcome again to today's discussion. We are so excited to have so many people here today. We are hosting Dr. Ruth Wilson Gilmore. The theme is a quote by Dr. Ruth Wilson Gilmore. Abolition requires we change one thing, everything. And today's event is hosted by the League of Revolutionaries for a New America. I'm speaking to you from Oakland, California. I want to acknowledge that this is the land of the Ohlone people, the indigenous people to Oakland and much of the Bay Area and Northern California. We understand that the capitalist wealth of this country was built from the genocidal land theft of the indigenous Americans. The Ohlone people have lived on this land for many generations and have survived colonization, violence, and displacement. The Ohlone are still unrecognized by the federal government and have no land base. This means that I am on unceded Indian land. We'd like to honor this land and the people who have stewarded it for generations and still do today. We know that the folks in the audience are coming from places all over the country and over the world, and we welcome you all into the call. We thank you for coming and encourage you to leave your cameras on if you're comfortable so that we can be in virtual community together. If you haven't already, please add your preferred pronouns and your location to your name. We appreciate our time together and look forward to us focusing on the work that we know we have to do at this time. We encourage you to take care of yourself with breaks as needed. As a community guideline, we ask that comments in the chat be respectful and made in the spirit of this event, which is respect and care for all people, equality and unity. We request you focus on the work that we're doing together and that you avoid putting distracting comments in the chat. We encourage you to put your questions for Ruth Wilson Gilmore into the chat or comments or questions that enhance the discussion at hand. Why are so many people here today on a beautiful Saturday afternoon in the middle of summer? It's because something important and new is happening across the country and across the globe. The last year and a half, as Lil Baby said, it has been a hell of a year. We the people, the working class, the 99%, as Occupy called it, we saw so much. We saw the government allow hundreds of thousands of people to die needlessly from COVID. We saw a pandemic of racial inequality, et cetera. A new consciousness is developing about the nature of what we are up against and about the kind of government and society that we must fight for today. A new consciousness is developing about the systemic nature of what we are up against. This consciousness was reflected in the 26 million people of all colors and ages, led by youth, who took to the streets last summer in response to the vicious police murder of George Floyd and so many other unarmed African Americans. Police in the United States kill over 1,000 people every year. Black, Indigenous, and Latinx Americans are murdered by the police at the highest rates, at 2 to 3 times the rate of white Americans. Yet it's also true that Americans of all colors, about half of them white, are murdered by cops every month, and with few repercussions. Almost all of those killed by the police are poor. There's a growing understanding among our people, the 99%, that although the police are paid for with our tax dollars, they do not work for us. The police work for the capitalist ruling class and their corporations to protect the white supremacist private property system for the wealthy. They do not keep us safe. There's also a growing awareness that the only thing that will keep us safe and protect our future for our children and the planet is for regular working people and unemployed people like us to come together to think and share and strategize a completely new future, an abolitionist future. And that's why we're here today. Today's event, Abolition Requires We Change One Thing, Everything, with Dr. Ruth Wilson Gilmore, is sponsored by the League of Revolutionaries for a New America. The League's mission is to bring together the freedom fighters like those on this call to strategize the creation of a cooperative society based on the principle that all humans should have their basic needs met regardless of ability to pay. No one should be homeless, hungry, undereducated, or gunned down or incarcerated by representatives of the government just because they are poor. The same advanced technology that today is used to eliminate jobs and destroy the earth could instead be used to reconstruct society, to provide abundance, true safety, freedom, and democracy for all. In the hands of the corporations, robotics and other digital technology are used to take away jobs and create massive private wealth for a tiny ruling class. But in the hands of the people, it could be used in the interest of all of society. This cooperative equal society is not pie in the sky, but a practical solution for the problems facing us today. The original abolitionists who fought to abolish legal chattel slavery of African Americans in the 16th, 17th, and 1800s were told that they could never win, that slavery was just a part of society, that they should accept that they were crazy to try to end it. Our abolitionist ancestors of all colors played their role, and today we will play ours. So today we are excited and humbled to be in discussion with our honored guest, Dr. Ruthie Wilson Gilmore, abolitionist scholar and activist who has contributed so much to this movement. In a moment, I will introduce our host who will be leading the discussion with Ruthie. After the discussion, which will center around a series of questions, we'll open up to bring the audience in. If you have a question, please put it in the chat and clearly note it as a question for Ruthie, along with your name and where you're from. We will get to as many questions as possible in the time that we have. And now, without further ado, I'd like to introduce our abolitionist hosts, Ms. Jerry Silva and Damon Williams. I'm so pleased to introduce Jerry Silva. Jerry Silva was born and raised in Los Angeles, where she spent the past 40 years in all forms of struggle for human, political, and economic rights. Over the years, Silva has been a compañera and collaborator with Ruth Wilson Gilmore, and Silva's work is acknowledged in Gilmore's 2006 book, Golden Gulag, about California prisons. Jerry Silva's activity covers the span from immigration rights to welfare rights to the right to decent housing for all in need. In the past 30 plus years, Jerry has fought against the rampant and ongoing abuses in the courts, at the hands of the police, and in the prisons. Silva was a founding member of numerous organizations, Mothers Reclaiming Our Children, Mothers ROC, or Mothers Rock, in 1992, Families to Amend California's Three Strikes, FACTS, in 1996, Fair Chance Project in 2009, California Families Against Solidarity Confinement in 2011, and Families United to End LWOP in 2017. Fuel is a proud member of CURB, Californians United for a Responsible Budget, and Drop LOP, LWOP, which stands for Life Without the Possibility of Parole or Death by Incarceration. And our other, thank you so much, Jerry, for being here today. Really appreciate it. So happy to have you. And our other fabulous co-host today is Damon A. Williams. Damon is a movement builder, organizer, hip-hop performing artist, educator, and media maker from the South Side of Chicago. Damon is the co-director of the Let Us Breathe Collective, an artistic activist organization birthed out of supply trips to support the Ferguson uprising in resistance to the murder of Mike Brown. Williams and Let Us Breathe continue to organize direct actions and community enrichment throughout the streets of Chicago and their movement building community center, the Breathing Room Space, with the mission of utilizing cultural production and popular education to redistribute power and resources, eradicate systemic violence, and transform inequity. In the summer of 2020, Damon co-created the Black Abolitionist and launched Defund CPD, a mass redistributive campaign aiming to redirect power and resources away from the Chicago Police Department. Damon is also the co-host of Ergo, a radio show and podcast showcasing cultural workers reshaping Chicago and beyond for the more equitable and creative. And now I'm going to turn it over to Jerry Silva. Thank you, Jerry.
Thank you so much, Kimberly. It is my distinct honor to introduce my friend, above all, world-renowned scholar, activist, and abolitionist in every sense of the word, Ruth Wilson Gilmore. She teaches geography at the City University of New York, where she is also the director of Center for Peace, Culture, and Politics. She's the author of award-winning Golden Gulag, Prison, Surplus, Crisis, and Opposition in Globalizing California. Her forthcoming books include Change Everything, Haymarket, and Abolition Geography, Essays Towards Liberation, Verso. She co-edited with Paul Gilroy, Stuart Hall, Selected Writings on Race and Difference, Duke. The documentary, Geographies of Racial Capitalism with Ruth Wilson Gilmore, features her internationalist analysis. She has co-founded many grassroots organizations, including California Prison Moratorium Project, Critical Resistance, and the Central California Environmental Justice Network. She's a California girl. Her honors include the 2020 Lannan Foundation Cultural Freedom Prize with Mike Davis and Angela Y. Davis, and was elected in 2021 to the Academy, American Academy of Arts and Sciences. This is a major accomplishment. Welcome, Ruthie.
Thank you, Jerry. Jerry, your picture has disappeared from my view. Is something over your camera? Yeah. There you are.
There. You're back. Everybody else is
back. Okay. They know if it was personal or not.
I'm a
Jerry Silva. Thank you. Thank you for that lovely introduction. Thank you for being my sister and my comrade over all these years. We met around 30 years ago,
at least,
give or take a few months or a few years. Mike Davis might've introduced us, I'm not sure, but he is the first person who told me about you. And I said, oh, who's that? Let me go find out. And we did a lot together. And we do a lot together, even though we are separated by time and space. We are joined in mind and heart, and especially in consciousness in the work that we do.
Absolutely. All right, let me get to the questions, Ms. Gilmore. Okay. In your new book, Change Everything, Racial Capitalism and the Case for Abolition, when you say change everything, what does that mean? What does everything encompass?
Everything. Everything. Now, I don't know how many of the 150, 160 people who have joined us today are worried about the idea of changing everything, but I assure you that many, many, many people imagine what that means is destroy everything, burn it to the ground. Once you have scorched the earth, sprinkle the earth with salt, plow the salt into the earth so that nothing can flourish for 7 years, then hope to start again. Well, that would be pretty foolish. So let's go back to that word change. Change everything means take things as they are and configure them anew to make what we need out of what we have. Now, you and Kimberly King have already indicated how that could be. I know that the work that Damon Williams and his comrades are doing also indicates how that could be. So I'm going to talk about this a little bit, giving examples. One of the most famous cop fighters in Los Angeles history was the late, great Black Panther, Michael Zinzin. And Michael Zinzin was, because he was a Panther, trying then in the 1960s and 70s and beyond, as we are trying now, to compel cops to stop killing people, stop killing poor people, stop killing Black people, stop killing working class people, regardless of race or ethnicity or citizenship status. That's what Zinzin was doing. And as Kimberly King reminds us, these killings haven't stopped over time. So Michael Zinzin, quite remarkably in the annals of bringing cops to account in any way, managed successfully to convict a judge and I guess a jury in the city of Pasadena that he had lost the sight in one of his eyes because of a brutal attack by one of their police. And he was paid, let's call it reparation. It wouldn't repair his eye, but he got a money award. Michael Zinzin used that money to establish the Coalition Against Police Abuse, an organization that he ran with very little help for many, many years, headquartered in South Central Los Angeles, where the people doing that work would do outreach to community, but also have an open door so that if somebody from the community, wherever they were and whoever they were, had a problem with police, they could come to the door, express what had happened, and at least build up a record of the struggles people had with police harming and killing their loved ones, invading their homes, destroying their self-earned property. Michael Zinzin thought a lot. He had a big head full of thought. And one of the conclusions he reached was, while it is true that police kill us, while it is true that we must continue on this campaign to stop that, it is also true that other things kill us and we can do things about that as well. Other things kill us and we can do things about that as well. And he became particularly concerned about the fact that so many children in working class communities, especially but not exclusively children who live in public housing, for our international guests, that would be called social housing in many places, that those kids were suffering from asthma and they were dying of it. And asthma should not kill anybody. It's an actually relatively easily treatable, if chronic, condition, but it has to be treated. And part of the treatment requires that the environment in which the person suffering from restricted airway disease, asthma, lives, has got to be free of certain kinds of harmful toxins. Michael Zinzin learned, as many other people learned in various places around the world, that one of the things that exacerbates childhood asthma is the stuff that gets into the air from the feces from vermin, from rodents and roaches. And for those of you who didn't know that roaches also produce feces, look under your sink, you will see. Michael Zinsen then embarked on a campaign to do two things. One of which was to alert people living in housing that were infested with vermin, that one of the key contributing factors to their children's ill health was this vermin, but also to realize that the chemical pesticides available in the grocery store to kill the vermin actually make the asthma worse. So spraying you know what under the sink does not solve the problem of vulnerability to premature death. So Zinsen did this work in Los Angeles. He also had quite an international profile, especially in the last 10 or 12 years of his life, and did some organizing with people in favelas in Brazil, did some organizing in Cuba and elsewhere. Now, at almost the same time that the late Michael Zinsen was developing this knowledge that he immediately turned into a campaign, there were right across Los Angeles, the thickly inhabited vastness of Los Angeles, right across on the east, northeast part of Los Angeles in the unincorporated Los Angeles Valley, unincorporated Los Angeles County, the mothers of East LA had kind of come to the same conclusion. And they had gotten to that conclusion by a different but very closely related path. In the early 1980s, the state of California had announced that it was going to build a jillion new prisons. And the first one would be built in East LA because, according to the then governor and the people in charge in Sacramento, in the state capital, the prison should be built in the communities where the prisoners will come from. And these mothers said, so why do these people up there in Sacramento assume that our kids are going to prison? Because obviously a prison that's not built yet is being built for some future generation of prisoners. So why are they assuming our kids are going to prison? So first the mothers organized and they stopped that prison. It was the last prison stopped until a huge and long struggle stopped the state from building any new prisons at all in the 21st century. But they also, the mothers, asked themselves, well, what is it about our kids, other than the easy answer, racism, compels these people in Sacramento to decide that Mexican-American children will go to prison. There've got to be things other in addition to that that explains the racism, that shows us the racism, because they don't write the laws saying, let's go arrest all the Black and Mexican-American kids and put them in prison. So what do they do? What the mothers did was they learned, for example, that many people who wind up in prison have lost time in school, and they lost time in school because many of them were sick a lot. And what were a lot of people sick from who missed school, especially elementary and middle and high school? Childhood asthma. So we get to the same problem by a different pathway, but it's still the pathway from organized violence of police and prisons to organized abandonment of the conditions under which people live their everyday lives. So having started there, so intensely in Los Angeles, I'd like to stretch out a little bit and point out that today we know throughout the US and also far, far beyond US borders, COVID is rampant inside prisons and jails, and people who have no way to socially distance, to get vaccines, et cetera, are facing ever more premature death than before. We also know that in many rural areas, whether or not in the United States, people who work in or near agricultural fields are exposed also to pesticides and the toxins that produce childhood asthma that results in some places, 1 in 4 children having childhood asthma, and as I said earlier, dying of it, even though it should not be fatal. So we've got urban, rural, questions of the environment, questions of abandonment, questions of housing, and an international stretch, a stretch from self-identified men who fight cops, self-identified mothers who fight prisons, and everybody and everything in between. Now, I'd like to point out at this moment that in the United States, at the second that we're talking, half of the entire labor force, it's like 75 or 80 million people, minimum, half of the entire labor force is in one way or another not documented to work. In fact, most of them are documented not to work because of a disqualifying arrest or conviction, regardless of what their citizenship status is. They have been documented not to work. So a fairly small fraction of that huge number are themselves the formal group or informal group of undocumented workers in the United States. Most, regardless of their citizenship status, green card status, are documented not to work because of an arrest or a conviction record. Now, we also know that in the early months of COVID, so a year and 5 months ago, first the US stock market went, right? It went down and many people thought, oh, here's the opportunity for everybody to understand that workers produce value, because look what happened. When everyone was told to stay home, the stock market went down. It turns out we're the ones who produce value. Well, in some places it remained down. In the US, it went back up. Went back up while everybody, which is to say people who did not fit the profile of essential workers, we'll talk about a little later, while everybody who was told to stay home stayed home, the stock market went back up. Now, why was that? Well, there are a couple of reasons. The first is the US stock market, as huge as it is, chock full of the old blue chip companies, like the automobile companies and steel companies and oil companies and so forth, and chock full of the new hot companies, newer, like Apple and Microsoft and so on and so forth, that market as a whole was dragged up, i.e. investors put their money back in, was dragged up, one, because of the tech companies that all seemed likely not only to endure the downturn well, but all seemed likely as well to benefit from the downturn by connecting people remotely, by making remote work possible, by connecting the world for Amazon and so forth. So those tech companies include Apple, Facebook, Amazon, Zoom was a new entrant, so forth. The other reason though, that the stock market went back up, and this is absolutely important, is that unusually for the overdeveloped economies of the world, the US allows employers to fire employees at will. Now, everyone who's in the US probably thinks, Gilmore, what are you talking about? Of course an employer can fire an employee. Not everywhere, comrades, in the US. Therefore, again, investors, wherever they were, whoever they were, and that includes pension funds for people like me and Kimberly, who are teachers, investors knew that firms, whether they are tech firms or other kinds of firms, could reduce their costs and return to profitability because they could lay off as many workers as they needed to and not hire them back until they wanted to, right? So this is what happened with the stock market. These things were entirely predictable. Entirely predictable. And if we go back, we will find that any number of people in both, engaged, very public facing lectures and scholarship, as well as in more academic or technical sounding writing, all said the same thing, that these are the things that would happen. And the people who didn't, of course, stay home, were the essential workers, like healthcare delivery, food production, and so forth. So I have a couple more things I wanna say about the everything, and then we'll go on to the next question, all right? So let's talk for a moment about agribusiness and food. And I mentioned the fact that in rural parts of the world, all kinds of people are exposed to many of the chemical inputs that make certain kinds of crops grow, but that destroy while also enhancing commodity value, right? So destroy earth, destroy workers, destroy air, destroy soil, and destroy water. Agribusiness, which kind of is one of the forms of multinational capital that kind of has the world in, as it were, in its grips, relies on the labor of at minimum 1.1 billion workers. So I mentioned 75 or 80 million workers in the US who are documented not to work. Now we're getting a little bigger. 1.1 billion people participate in agricultural activity. And there's additional people who make the machines, fix the machines and so forth. So we're talking about people who have something to do with what happens in the fields or in the sea, you know, with fish and seafood. And the five big, well, there are six now, big agribusiness firms that are so incredibly powerful, like Archer Midland Daniels and Cargill and Bungie. There's a new entrant that's got a mix of Chinese state capital and private capital that's coming out of China called Kofco, a couple others. They are relying on all of those workers, most of whom are organized at ground level in very small producer groups. So we have small production leading up to these vast global networks of agribusiness, which then gives us some idea of part of the everything that we could change that we can already see might be changeable. And I'll come back again later in our time together and talk about that in a little bit of detail. The agribusiness firms also are doing something that might surprise people who concluded that the current phase of global capitalism that we're living through is one completely dominated by banks and financial institutions. The surprise is they're setting up their own cryptocurrency capacity, knocking the banks out of the picture so that they can compel their suppliers up and down the chain to participate without the middleman or middle person in transferring value up and down. The cryptocurrency capacity. So cryptocurrency, for those of you who know, things like Bitcoin, and I don't understand how it works, but I know that it does work. The cryptocurrency capacity might well have knocked banks out of the picture, but they demand the equivalent amount of electricity on an annual basis as the entire country of Argentina uses for all purposes on an annual basis, or the entire country of Switzerland uses for all purposes on an annual basis, or the entire country of, it's pretty close, Denmark. So these are, you know, pretty well-to-do countries that I'm talking about. They use a lot of electricity for a lot of reasons, for production, reproduction, household, so forth. And the cryptocurrency from these small firms use that much electricity, which gives us, again, some idea of the enormity of capacity, but also the enormity of possibility in things that we can do. And the last point I want to make at this point, part of our conversation, is to talk a little as well, having raised healthcare and raised healthcare workers as essential workers, about the kinds of things that are happening in the US and beyond with healthcare workers on their own behalf. So I've had the opportunity to talk with the National Nurses United and speak with some of their political education people within that union, but also speak to the entire union at during their annual conference last September and do some other things and talk a bit about the things we're talking about today. And to get a sense of the ways that in particular, healthcare workers, and especially but not exclusively nurses, see every aspect of the contradictions that I'm talking about, whether or not they're concerned about them, they see them because they're all in their faces. They work for massive multinationals like Hospital Corporation of America, massive corporations. They are compelled by their employer not to organize for one big union that can stand up to the entire firm, but locals, right? So divide and conquer, divide and conquer, divide and conquer. They tend to have a fairly high representation of long distance migrants, people who have moved from one country to another, whether they plan to return to some point of origin or some intermediary point or intend to stay where they're at, should make no difference. They have moved. Many are responsible for sending remittances home in order to enhance the economic well-being of their households and communities. So some people probably know that the Philippines has at Manila, its major airport, has special exit gates for people who work in healthcare and domestic labor who are long distance migrants. They have their own exit gates. And if you go some other places in the world, you will see that there are special entry gates for people like the people coming from the Philippines or Eritrea, Sierra Leone, or Nigeria to come in and have their passports stamped so they can get to work quickly and not have to wait in lines. So we have a sense of a global consciousness on the part of people who are organizing themselves for their locals, but also organizing their national union, which is the biggest healthcare workers union in the United States, as well as organizing a group called Global Nurses United, which now has chapters and presences in many places, including in Brazil. So some of these examples that I have just shared with you, starting with Michael Zinzin and ending, who had a presence in Brazil, and ending with the National Nurses United, who also now have a presence in Brazil, give us some sense of what I mean when I say everything. I really do mean everything. And it's everything that we can look at, think about, understand, and find people already doing things about.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. So I want to make a little bit of time to open up and, you know, in that answer, I think you spoke to it, but to talk about your vision of what abolitionist future looks like. But before that, I am just compelled to offer love and honor to both you, Ruthie, and Jerry on behalf of Chicago movement here, organizations such as Let Us Breathe Collective, the Black Abolitionist Network, the R3 Coalition. There's a deep tie, and everybody watching, there's a deep tie between Chicago and California. So I'm honored to be here and to be a part of this conversation. And I think that connection is really important. And so much of this legacy has changed not only my life, but my whole community's life. There's so many people that know each other and are deeply rooted in continuing the legacies of so many of the things that y'all have contributed to and built. So just one deep love, honor, and appreciation. And thank you, Kimberly, for having me. But in talking about, you know, making space from all those things we need to change, really would love to hear about your vision and what do these abolitionist geographies look like? So language that you have used that has become popularized is the 21st century. He made this point in the latter part of the 20th century. He said, you know, Karl Marx didn't invent communism. He observed it. He observed it and then thought about it. And then he wrote as much as he could to show people as much as he could show them about what possibilities were to change things. Right. And if I may, you know, take on the mantle of both Marx and Touré here, I will. I didn't invent abolition, right? But I do think that I observe it. And the only reason I observe it is not because I'm like this individual genius any more than, as Kwame Touré was trying to say of Marx, that Marx was like, you know, sitting in the British Library by himself with his books, thinking, what is the world and how can I write people out of it? What I see and why I have, you know, come to the conclusion, which is to say the starting point that abolition is presence, which by the way, Damon, I first said in Chicago. Hey,
I first said those words in Chicago.
Squad.
Of course. 2017. Is I thought very hard about what, for example, Du Bois was talking about in Black Reconstruction in America. Like, why did he write all those pages, man? Why all those pages? Why is like chapter after chapter after chapter after chapter? It's a long book. And it's one that I think everybody should read, but it's a long book. And it's a long book in which, as he says at the end, that the standard histories of Reconstruction, which were themselves very long books, were bad. He said, the historians said so much because they saw so little. They said so much because they saw so little. Now, Du Bois was not then encouraged to write a short book but rather to write a long book so he could show us what he saw that all those other historians, in his view, had missed. And for people who are listening in, you might know that Du Bois was from Western Massachusetts. He went to Harvard, of all schools, where he studied history. Then he went off to Berlin, to Humboldt University, and studied sociology. And so he had this kind of interdisciplinary take on things, but the whole time that he was studying these things and going these places and trying to understand the world, he had a commitment to changing it so that long before writing Black Reconstruction in America, Du Bois had already concluded one must be a socialist to undo this mess we're in, like long before, and before the Great Depression and all that, like long, long, long before. So Du Bois shows us in Black Reconstruction the kinds of things that people did. And it was in reflecting again on that and on having read so many works from the 18th and 19th century written by abolitionists, including people who had been enslaved, people who had passed through as sailors and so on and so forth. We see the same thing. The people make lives. And what abolition is making those lives and having them flourish rather than having the absence of a legal category set out into the world. So abolition then is presence in that people in during Reconstruction in the United States were making all kinds of things, public education, community well-being. One of the footnotes in that book is one that I like to show off because I can quote from memory. Du Bois writes, "The experience of the Negro worker during Reconstruction provides the researcher with the opportunity to study inductively the Marxian theory of the state." And I know we're going to talk about the theory of the state later, but there I'm going to put that out. That Du Bois kept seeing these things, and it's the presence of making that world, which itself got flat during the next period, which was redemption, but people really made that, and a lot of that knowledge and capacity and imagination and vision has persisted into where we are. So you said, Damon, about what we elders may have done that has shaped what younger people do. And we ourselves are shaped by the past, people who were elders to us and elders to them and so on and so forth. So we're carrying it through. We're not going back to before, but we're pulling through the kind of genius that we are all capable of realizing. I'll say a couple of other examples. We're going back to Brazil again because I like to think about Brazil, and Brazil is going through such a hard time, and yet on the ground, there are amazing things happening. The landless workers movement, the MST, shows us how abolition is present in all of the things that the MST does. Land occupations, agricultural work, establishment of schools, a central training school for theory as well as practice, and the fact that teams will go from the MST anywhere in the world to help people develop their capacities for agriculture, for community, for schools, and so forth, anywhere in the world. And so they have very close relations with people in Indonesia and with people who live in the self-built communities on land occupations in South Africa, in Durban and Cape Town and so forth. They share technological techniques and they share seeds, all of the above. And so right now in the year 2021, The MST is Latin America's biggest producer of organic rice. Biggest producer of organic rice. And they slide that rice past the blockades into Venezuela, past the blockades, I imagine also into an island 90 miles off the US coast, and as well as elsewhere. So that is abolitionist presence. So it need not be that the MST say we're abolitionists for me to see abolition, just as it need not have been for anybody who Marx trained his attention on to say we are communists for him to see communism, right? It's like this is kind of analytical as well as a sense of what the historical personality and purpose of the work is. Mother's Rock was abolitionist. And it, I mean, back when people said, what are you talking about? It was. And then I'll give one other brief example. I have two more. Well, let's see how we're doing with time. In India today, another place that's suffering a lot because the central government has been seized by fascists. That fact put the entire vast country at peril in the context of COVID. And yet, because of the diversity of the country, of political formations, of the fact that communists and other people for whom the needs of the people come first have a rather important presence, the outcome of COVID vulnerability in India has not been evenly experienced in all of the areas of the country. So, for example, in Kerala, which is southwest India, on the Indian Ocean, that state developed a development plan for itself decades ago that was development, not growth. Development, not growth. The purpose was to figure out how it could be possible for the 30 million or so people who are resident in that state to flourish. Now, it's not a place without its contradictions. Of course, it has them. And many people from Kerala are long distance migrants to other parts of India and more frequently across the Gulf into the Gulf states, the oil states. But one of the things that Kerala committed to do for itself, for the people, was to develop the capacity to make oxygen in case it would be needed. As a result, during the terrible periods of COVID in India, which are probably have not come to the end, to an end as they have not elsewhere, Kerala had the capacity to make oxygen so that people in Kerala could use it, and then they could also ship it out to nearby areas. Now, completely different kind of organization, the Sikh communities that are more centered in the north, in the states that surround Delhi, which is the capital of India, so Uttar Pradesh, Haryana, and so forth. The Sikh communities with a different kind of social organization that's based very much in their faith community centers also developed the capacity to make oxygen. So two of the principal suppliers of oxygen for those in need have been Sikhs who give it out to people who need it. In other words, they're not selling it, they're giving it, and the Kerala Communist Socialist Government. So this also shows me abolition, right? It also shows me. So why don't we move on, because I'll talk all day.
Which isn't a bad thing at all.
Yeah, we love it.
You know, Ruthie, I'm reminded as you're speaking, when I had interviewed you and Craig on my now what would I call it? Not radio show, Think Outside the Cage. And we were talking about abolition, and I was talking about people's opposition to the word. And Craig said, people are doing abolition work all the time, and this is what you're talking about now. And I think that's so important. It's one doesn't have to claim to be, it's just happening. But I wanted to also, you know, people are working, but we also have a laborless economy. Millions and millions of people have been made permanently surplus. Electronics has taken so, industry's been gone, but electronics has taken the place of workers. And how does this surplus population survive in this new economy? The League has written about the growth of an abolitionist class that must abolish private property to survive. And, you know, we're seeing so much activity and movement building around the world. You've talked about it. So exciting to hear about it. People are fighting for their basic needs to stay alive, including coming together of these movements. And I'm seeing this in Los Angeles. It's very exciting. But to me, the rub comes with making the leap then to class consciousness and understanding that the realization of our basic needs will not be met under capitalism or a better governor or a better, any of the betters that are, you know, representative of capitalism. So, you know, from your huge vantage point, how are you seeing the development of class consciousness within these movements?
Mm-hmm. No, that's a great question. And I think my inclination is almost to continue saying what I was talking about in response to Damon's question, that as people develop the relationships and the practices and the skills and the sharing and the solidarity that is characterized, you know, at the most intimate scale by the kinds of mutual aid groupings that not only rose up in the last year and a half because of COVID, but have characterized the lived experience of vulnerable people all over the planet all the time in the last 500 years. You know, whether they're saving societies, burial societies, so on and so forth. All of these, these formations give a glimpse into how people can see themselves and do see themselves through to the other side from imagining that, as you put it, a nicer corporation will do the trick, or a different governor will finally set everybody free. I mean, we just had a big change in president in the United States, and policing is about to get worse, which we all knew. Like, it was entirely predictable. And here we are. And that's why I was OMGing about Chicago, because I read the report of the Chicago police chief going to meet with the attorney general and coming back with his action plan. All right. So, what It is true, as you say, that people are fighting for survival. But the thing that I find the most inspiring is the fact that you already know Jerry, and you already know Damon, and probably the whole organizing committee of this fantastic group already knows that nobody actually fights just for survival. People actually have a sense of life that we want to live. It's got aesthetic dimensions, it's got pleasurable dimensions, it's got different kinds of food, you name it. We know this is true for people who are locked up. We know this is true for people who are in the free world. We know it's true for people who, as I was talking about earlier, who've been pushed and pulled from places where they used to live, whatever they were like, and who have wound up in the rapidly expanding urban megacities of mostly the global south. And a good deal of the newer parts of those cities are parts that were built by the people who lived there. They established houses, established schools, established entire communities, established forms of government. I just read a really fantastic book about that called Amakomiti in South Africa. And in the context of the things that people do, we see arising, again, I'm just repeating myself, relationships to one another and to the land that do not involve in any way alienating the land, turning land into a commodity that can be sold, that do not involve prioritizing turning energy into money that then somebody can take the most of, and yet are stuck with the realization that so much of everyday life requires some form of money because so much of everyday life has become monetized, right? If you can't grow it, you have to buy it. If you can't get to your job on your motorbike without having some fuel, you've got to buy the fuel. You know, there's one thing after another after another. So there are people who have developed, for example, entire, really elaborate systems to get around the need to have money to buy things that maybe they can make. Now, one might think, oh, well, Gilmore, you're talking about food, you know, dishes or something like that. No, I'm talking about people who know how to wield tools that can make from scrap metal parts to repair cars and parts to do all kinds of things. So I met some people, for example, in Marrakesh last year or 2 years, I don't remember when it was, before the pandemic, who had developed a project where all kinds of skilled workers who live in Marrakesh, who know how to do various parts of metal and other work, could get together and build their own motorbikes so they wouldn't have to import them from somewhere else. I mean, this is just another example. So everything that we do is susceptible to being snatched by capitalism and turned into a commodity to be sold back to us. We know this. So the question is, I put back to you and I put to the audience that we have, how and to what extent have people figured out how to shield the creativity, problem solving, product making, energy and enthusiasm that people engage in, whether they're growing organic rice in Brazil that is of such huge quantities that it's going all kinds of places, or making a dozen motorbikes in Marrakesh, or producing oxygen in Haryana or Kerala, what are the methods through which people protect these activities from becoming commodified by capitalism? And that, to me, is just like straight up political work. And to me, I guess I'll say further, as inspired as I am to see work that I understand to be abolitionist happening all over the world, also makes me worry that there aren't something that would be the equivalent of parties to protect that work, right? Something that would be the equivalent of some kind of formal, institutional, reproducible structure to protect the work. The MST has that. I mean, they're not a party that runs candidates for elected office, but they do all of the other stuff that a party would do. So that is something that is hugely needed. We can also think about the role that extraction plays in everything that we do. That the fact is that the machines that we are all using today to be able to have this incredible and precious conversation together have in them pieces of the Democratic Republic of Congo, Bolivia, Chile, labor power transferred into them, probably in East Asia, Southeast Asia, sand that was extracted from shorelines in many parts of the world and transported in those big ships, like the one that got stuck in the Suez Canal, that come around to for making glass. Like all of this activity, again, gives us some notion of what the possible political work might be on the ground. So I'm going to use a word that's a little old-fashioned, and I'm not really sure where to go with it. But there certainly has been a huge struggle in places like Chile and Bolivia and the DRC and elsewhere over what should happen with the mineral wealth, with the raw materials that are taken out of the ground. And should the control of those goods, even before they become commodities, be determined by the people who live above the ground, as well as the people who do the work, wherever they live. And this, of course, is the struggle that mine workers are engaged in all over the planet. And they're working, right? They haven't been replaced by machines. Some have, many haven't. This is the work that the new Chile government that's about to write a new constitution is confronted with. The biggest copper mine on the planet is in Chile, right? In Chile. So there is some kind of residual sense, now I'm finally getting to that word I promised I'd use, residual sense of a kind of residual nationalism, like resource nationalism. You know, we, whose territory this is, ought to be able to decide kind of view of what might be considered by some reactionary, by others revolutionary. And the question is, how and to what extent can the people who sit on these resources that make possible the kind of connections that we are so eager to encourage and help flourish, how can they, which is to say, in a strict moment of solidarity, how can we determine the use of those things? And this gets us back to the question of automation being, on the one hand, apparently so dire because it replaces human labor, but on the other hand, kind of promising because we could have more time to paint paintings and write books and make music and calm the misery of environmental degradation.
Sorry, I was just getting a little note about from some of the tech team. But yeah, I mean, one, that's so powerful. I want to toss ahead You mentioned having something about the state and just wanted to real quick take that route of, you know, the language of organized abandonment, organized violence has been used to discuss this anti-state state concept. And so just want to take a little bit of time to elaborate on that. And also in that elaboration, what should we see the function of the responsibility of the state, particularly for movement spaces and radical spaces and people that are interested in these revolutionary ideas. I want to shout out also the Chicago Torture Justice Center, which I work with, that is always wrestling with this question in a very material way with survivors of police torture and coming out of the only reparations ordinance and center of domestic torture in the United States. So shout out to all my CTJC fam. And so we're always thinking about this relationship to the state, what that responsibility looks like as we are working with the survivors of this organized violence. And so for you, what is that function and responsibility of the anti-state state or the state that we need to build?
Okay. Another good question. These are all good questions. The anti-state state is a concept that I developed having spent an awful long time back in the 90s when Jerry and I saw a lot of each other, trying to understand how it was possible that two things were happening that should not have been able to happen together. On the one hand, people were elected, you know, ran for state office and were elected to state office, whatever level, you know, local, state, federal, saying, we're going to end the state as we know it. We're against it. It's just going to go away. We're going to dissolve it. It will be gone. So that was happening. And then, because I'm a nerd, I looked at budgets, and the budgets were going boom, 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 boom. I thought, well, what is this? What is this? What is this? So the anti-state state was the best way I could summarize my understanding of what was going on, which was that all different kinds of people from both of the main, you know, capitalist political parties, as well as many others, swore that the problems that people were experiencing in their lives were created by something called the government. So if the government got out of their lives would magically get better. But then, having been elected or appointed, many of them were appointed to, you know, jobs like the head of this or the chief of that, having been elected or appointed, then what they had was this little bit of a legitimation crisis. It's like, well, I can't really preside over undoing my entire base of power, can I? And still have power, will I? So there was an enormous and protracted effort on the part of all different kinds of people to legitimate the growing complex institutions that they claimed they were going to undo by beefing up in almost every instance some version of organized violence, which is to say police work, police or military work, while at the same time, in a very organized way, helping capital to abandon all the people who once upon a time might have depended directly or indirectly on the lives and livelihoods produced by, you know, factory work and so on and so forth, by union protected labor. So all of these things happened at once. And if I were to show you a slide, at all right now, the one I would show is that a slide that demonstrates that US workers have, contrary to slander, been remarkably productive forever. While their rate of unionization has taken a dive from its all-time high in the 1950s. And as the rate of unionization has gone down and productivity has gone up, not surprisingly, can you see this gap between my arms? All right, profits are up here and wages are down here. So drop in unions, rise in productivity, drop in share of value made. Now, we've already dismissed capitalism as the mode through which we can save ourselves, but it's yet another indication of exactly how thoroughly the abandonment of workers and their community, households and their communities, by capital flight, and the abandonment of workers, households, and communities by the retrenchment of the always weak and always unevenly available welfare state left people in the lurch, and the forces of organized violence filled that gap. So my favorite example of this is that the US Department of Education has its own SWAT team.
Oh my God.
So we know cops in schools, and many people are working to get cops out of schools. USED has its own SWAT team. I can go example after example after example where, you know, policing practices have been welded into the work of people like me, whose day job it is. I'm a public employee and I'm supposed to teach. And I'm also supposed to, you know, scrutinize people and, you know, do all these trainings that tell me how to be a better cop in my place of work. And I want to say something too about militarism. So the forces of organized violence are not only police, but also obviously the military. And the militarism that the US and its many partners engage in around the planet is a combination of endless wars with frontline soldiers there and proxy wars, which is to say wars in which the fighters are not US citizens or permanent residents in US uniforms, but still are involved in perpetual warfare on behalf of the more powerful nation states or imperial states on the planet. And as a result of this combination of conflict and environmental harm that militaries produce because their carbon footprint is enormous, and therefore they are one of the causes of climate change. A result of conflict and environmental harm that militaries produce means that there is an ever greater number of long distance migrants in search of a place to be calm and have the kinds of things that we've been talking about. The ability to have a life that includes safety, security, and beauty. So the United Kingdom and the United States both have developed policies in which one of their, I guess, spying practices is to figure out where large numbers of climate refugees might be moving from and where, what direction they're moving in order to interrupt them. And as I mentioned, many of the wars that the US has been fighting have been proxy wars. And this proxying of, which is to say having a stand-in work on behalf of the US, has extended as well to long distance migrant detention centers. And these centers, there are some in the United States that people are extremely distressed about and along the border, we've heard a lot about, and rightly so, but there are many detention centers that are all outside of US territory. So in Mexico, in Central America, in Libya and to the south of Libya, in Turkey, you name it, that these detention centers have become the places, oh, and that island off Australia as well, have become places where the US and other wealthy countries, wealthy capitalist countries, you know, push people, migrants, into inaction so that they, these people in their households and communities cannot find relief from conflict, from economic privation, and from climate change. So this, the disorder today that I thought we might talk about if we have time, but if not, another time. The disorder today that's in US cities, that's in many cities, in cities in South Africa and elsewhere, was again, like these other things that I've been talking about, entirely predictable, entirely predictable. Like abandon people and then be surprised that people refuse it. And then be surprised that so many people at a loss for how to express themselves find, modeled by the state, violence, the most effective way, mode of speech. Like modeled by the state, modeled by the state, modeled by the state. The most effective form of speech. So while a lot of the uproar in the newspapers and on television and with the chief of police from Chicago rushing to DC and elsewhere purports to be telling us in the US context that crime is worse than it's ever been before because of some huge leap. Look at the numbers. The numbers are quite different, even though there are these terrible things happening, which again, I will say were entirely predictable, entirely. So there are two things going on. One, people on the ground figuring out, as happened in the early 90s, Jerry was there, in South Central LA, where gangsters figured out, oh, if we make peace, things are gonna be different around here. And they did. And they did. And then, and this is really tied to so many of the things that we've been talking about today, in Los Angeles, after many of the street organizations came together and sat down in an independent mosque and wrote a peace treaty out and agreed to it, and things which had been getting better anyway got a lot better. Then there was this like little spike. Murder rate suddenly went up briefly. And the main reason for that, which is to say the main reason people were dying suddenly again, was that the city and county had closed the trauma center in South Central Los Angeles, and therefore a wound, which I am not excusing, a wound was more likely to take somebody's life than before. Now, if we look at what has happened with hospitals around the United States, the fact that there are vast areas of the rural United States where there are no hospitals whatsoever, no hospitals whatsoever anymore. Indeed, vast areas of the rural United States where in some cases, communities thought that if they approved a prison in their midst, they could save their hospital because they thought, well, surely if they put a prison here, they're not going to let the prisoners die, and therefore we'll be able to keep our hospital. They were wrong, right? That this kind of organized abandonment that we can see in so many different aspects of everyday life afflicts us now with a disorder that we confront today. Okay.
So the other thing I think we're all reading about the uptick in violence in this country, it's also clear that the violence is being generated by the capitalist class, the state that needs the violence to undo the work of the class that has been, you know, calling for end to the violence against us. And it's now more than ever, we really need organization. I think I was really glad you brought up some kind of an organization that can bring people together and develop the consciousness that it's not just one struggle and we're gonna, you know, pull out of this together. Anyway, though, Ruthie, you've talked about racial capitalism as all capitalism. You've talked about the concept of race as vulnerability to premature death, absolutely. Can you explain these concepts and why they're so important to the liberation of all society?
Be happy to. And let me ask a question. It's getting dark here because it's evening. Do I need to put more light on or can you see me okay?
No, you're good. Okay?
Okay, my yellow wall is so kind to me. All right, here we go. Again, I like to share with people how I got to thinking the way that I got to think, just to kind of demystify. So that people don't think, oh, she sits in a room at a desk with a lot of books and then has a thought and then it's done. So, In the late 1990s, right before Bill Clinton left office as president of the United States, so it might have even been the year 2000, he commuted the sentences of several women who had been serving very long terms on crack cocaine charges. And everybody who's listening knows that under federal law, the crack cocaine convictions were like way, 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 way longer than powder cocaine convictions. And surprise, surprise, the demographics of the people convicted under these two different things was quite different. And so a group of us, Deborah Peterson Small and Angela Y. Davis and Kimba Smith, who was one of the people whose sentence was commuted, and another person whose sentence was commuted, I think, as I recall, her name was Dorothy Gaines. We hit the road to talk to people about this problem so they could speak from their experience of having been among the few who got out, so many still suffering inside, and to talk in general about the criminalization of working people, working and workless people. And in preparation for that event, and I'll tell you that in this particular event, everybody who participated was Black. We were not in the least under the impression that only Black people suffered from these problems, but I will tell you that. I was thinking a lot about the various things I had learned from so many people who had spent time locked up. So many, 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 many people. So at the time, I'd been working with Dorsey Nunn for a while, one of the founders of All of Us Are Nunn. I'd been working with just so many people. And it became clear to me that on top of, or in addition to everything else that putting a human in cages does to that human, their households and communities. It certainly shortens their lives. And then I thought, well, maybe I should think more expansively about how we can understand racism. And instead of thinking that racism is something that group A does to group B, rather that racism is the result of a whole series of relationships, institutions, and outcomes. And then, as I continued thinking, I was reminded of an article I read in some journal, like of medical sociology or something, by a couple of professors who taught at the school where I got my PhD. They weren't my direct teachers, but I read their work, Mike Greenberg and Donna Schneider. And the article was called Violence in American Cities. Young Black Men is the Answer, But What Was the Question? And it was like, whoa, isn't that a good title? What was the question? And the first sentence of that article is, you find the answers to the questions you ask. So I thought, well, maybe I could produce, you know, really think hard about and make what for me would be a definition of racism that might compel people to ask different questions from the obvious ones of, oh, these people do it to those people, that it's somehow a matter of bad attitude or intent as against structures and so forth. So I wrote this thing, which is such a mouthful, but group differentiated vulnerability to premature death, right? That's what racism is. It's state-sponsored or extra-legal production and exploitation of group differentiated vulnerability to premature death. So some guy who was like really, really keen to prove me wrong and stupid jumped on me at a conference one day and said, well, that's ridiculous because, you know, the Irish people who built the Erie Canal died more prematurely than people who were enslaved in the South. And I said, you just proved my point. Like quite the opposite of you taking me down. You thought I meant racism meant Black people because I'm Black, as against I meant racism meant group differentiated vulnerability to premature death, which is what happened to the Irish people who built the dug Erie Canal. So there we go. So it's racism that definition wishes to put into people's consciousnesses so that it's possible to think of all of these things, like who dug the Erie Canal and what is happening with the opioid crisis in rural America and so on and so forth. And to understand with my mentor, the late Cedric Robinson, how racial thinking underlies the entire logic of capitalism, period. Right? Racial thinking underlies the entire logic of capitalism, period. Again, not because Black people suddenly came into the picture, but rather, as Robinson argues in his book, because of how in the context of capitalism as it arose in England and in the colonial relation that England had with Ireland and so forth, that the people who became the owners and those who had effective control over capital saw the people who worked for them who were local, all of whose descendants might be white today, saw them in racial terms, whether it was the Welsh coal miners or the certain peasants from the English countryside or Irish people, so forth. Am I saying they weren't white? I'm saying the distinctions were racial. This is the important thing. Again, even if all of their descendants are white today. So Robinson got this idea or was inspired to think about racial capitalism by his interactions with anti-apartheid trade union organizers in South Africa and the frontline states, right? So COSATU and so forth, who had come up with a phrase of their own, which we don't have time maybe to go into now, but I'd love to talk about in another conversation. And theirs was racial Fordism. And at a time when a certain kind of industrializing development that would enable the people who made the product to afford to buy the product, that's what Fordism is, was as the workers, the comrades in South Africa saw was a racial system too, which it was for Ford as well. You remember, he was a great admirer of Hitler. So why all this? It's because capitalism requires inequality. It does. It requires it. It requires it. Capitalism requires inequality, and racism enshrines inequality. Capitalism absolutely requires it. It requires it because there has to be an equal power in relation to property. Because if there isn't, it means that the workers can go to work and make their widgets or make their cars or make their agricultural products or make whatever and then take it home, right? So there has to be a system of inequality. I didn't say poverty, I said inequality. There has to be a system of inequality in place that enables some people to reap the benefit, which is to say, to appropriate privately the socially produced wealth. And this is where, to go back to the 19th century, that nappy-headed philosopher Karl Marx took a look and said, man, if we could just like get rid of that inequality and make the self-earned property of the worker be the center of life, life would be different, wouldn't it? Wouldn't it? Wouldn't it? So racism, group differentiated vulnerability to premature death, how does it happen? Exposure to toxins, various deprivations, the kind of research that's done to solve some health problems, but not others, and so forth. And I had something, a kind of big thing I wanted to end on, if I could, that has to do with land and water. Do we have time?
We have probably maybe 15 more minutes in the program. So a few more minutes and then we'll go to the rest.
Okay. Like I said, I tend to be long when, all right. So I think maybe we could consider how internationalism is essential to our struggle. And an abolitionist international is something that I and others have been trying very hard to help develop over time and space. Talking, planning, plotting, connecting, sorting, all of these things over time. And in some ways, the international is here, but what we make of it will shape the future in the now as people keep doing what we do. And just to pick up the point that you made, Jerry, about organization, everything that's worth doing, as Mariam Kaba says, is only worth doing if we can do it with other people. And by extension, my entire experience of political life, through my 71st year, into my 72nd year, is that if you organize with people who are already organized, things happen that don't happen when you're not. So the environmental justice work that attached to anti-prison work, the long distance migrant work attached to nursing and mine workers and so on and so forth are all examples of working with people who are already organized, who themselves are very often struggling to democratize, to radicalize the organizations in which they find themselves. I mean, there are plenty of criticisms that people make, and rightly so, about large-scale trade unions. That doesn't mean, in my view, that they should be, you know, turned into scorched earth and people start all over again. That those two are institutional structures that can be turned to different use. So I want to just end here a couple more minutes to talk about two big things, which are Amazon and Amazon. So on the one hand, there's Amazon, my friend Paul Gilroy calls the cornucopia of capitalism, Amazon that links so much of the world together. And I've talked about other big tech companies, so it's not the only one, but it's one that we can think about together, especially because the guy whose wealth hit $188 billion the other day just burned a whole lot of money to pretend to go to outer space when millions of people in the United States are about to become homeless when the eviction moratorium ends, right? This is where we are. Now, some people, including my friends there in Los Angeles at the Economic Roundtable, are in concert with others, are trying to make the argument that Amazon should be a public utility, that it, like water and electricity and all these other things, that when they're interrupted by capitalist neglect or appropriation, turn out to be deadly and deathly, whether we look at the Paradise Fire in Northern California, what happened in Texas during the freeze, and so forth. These public utilities should actually be public. This is a step toward ending the hegemony of private property. So that's what Amazon should be. And if we look at how Amazon is stretched around the world and how a good deal of Amazon, even though the company has enormous market power and can direct firms to make goods to its specifications, it also organizes all kinds of little producers, all kinds of independent producers, because that's the way they can get their products to market. So we see, as we see with agribusiness, the fact that on the ground, there's a multitude of people, and the multitude, the many, if you will, are where organizing should focus and where perhaps we can find hope. So I want to say one last thing about Amazon, which is the other Amazon, the lungs of the planet, the Amazon, that huge tropical forest in Brazil, which until very recently has been what we call a carbon sink. That is to say, it brings the carbon in to the forest and enables oxygen, therefore, to circle the earth. Because of the expropriation, which is to say the ongoing theft of lands, both from indigenous people and from other smallholders, whether indigenous Afro-descended or not, because their land has been taken from them in order to produce, for example, beef for McDonald's or agricultural products to go into biofuels, right? Everybody will think they're all ethical using biofuels. The Amazon has been burned extensively. And as a result of the actual burning and the shrinkage of the forest, it is becoming, for the first time in the history of this period of the planet's geologic history, to becoming a carbon source instead of a carbon sink. There's one other kind of an auxiliary lung on the planet, which is a forest that's mostly in the Democratic Republic of Congo, where, as you'll remember, cobalt and copper for our electronic doodads comes from as well. So protecting these forests and thinking about Amazon, which should be a public utility, and Amazon, which is the kind of the infrastructure for the maintenance of life on this planet, are things that we can do together. And as I hope I've showed in my answers to the questions, there's always something specific, that the huge and general and grand schemes that I've presented are always huge and general and grand schemes that have a very concrete basis on which people can act today, whether it's supporting union organization, supporting the MST. Don't think that not using plastic straws is going to fix things. We have to organize. We can't just withdraw. Okay.
Ruthie, thank you so much. You've given us a course in everything today. Not only abolish everything, change everything, but we have a full-on international course on what's happening, and it's exciting to hear about it. We're going to close, but I really want you to know thank you. I mean, we would have had a bigger thank you, but we're kind of at the end of time. But I do want us to be able to hear Damon. He's going to send us out today.
Actually, Damon is not going to be the last. We're going to have one more closing right after Damon, but we're very excited to hear Damon.
Okay, Damon, go for it.
Welcome to the journey to freedom. Those before us left lessons, we gonna learn and repeat them. We not gonna follow directions because we know that they cheating. The game has been rigged, but into the code and you'll beat it. The North Star ain't the brightest, but it's the one that you're seeing. Just follow your spirits because you was born with the secrets. We gonna find what we seeking. Hearts gonna keep beating. Every day is the party. It don't just start on the weekend. We going harder than semen, marching, discarding our demons. Bombarding the garden led by the daughters of Eden. We are all that we needed, clever and never defeated. We do it better together. They want us broken, competing. We defining this moment, giving life a new meaning. We defying the owners, open and bold with our treason. We be smoking and drinking because we be coping with trauma, drama, mama fussing, cussing, and little cousins be bleeding. All the homies be tweaking, getting locked up for no reason. Hunting us all year, we not just cuffed in the season. Catching feelings, healing, but still throwing shade in the evening. If you saw the impossible, would that make you believe it? Boarding up our schools, they still don't want us reading. Trying to shut us up because they don't want us screaming. But we done woke up now. We'll show them what we've been dreaming. Oh, they got us fucked up. But here come the redeeming. I stop. Move to the beat of my drum. Who can you feed with a crumb? And what can you grow with a seed? Our body don't burn in the sun. Build it up and then they'll come. Can't freely have fun with your funds. We know that freedom ain't free. We need role models and teachers for this world swallowing eaters. But it's hard to know who to follow when everyone around you's a leader. Do it for Darion and Adia, Dame Mo and Rakia. We'll fix it or break it down, but one way or another, they'll see us. What happened when bullshit's abolished? Well, hustlers put kids through college. We learn money can't fix every problem, or we don't need their schools to get knowledge. But we still gonna grind for them dollars. Ain't no leash or tie on my collar. The stories revise, we writing the lies. No rock and roll, but we got honor. Rock and roll, no Madonna. No Rolling Stones, no Nirvana. I'm Chuck Berry and I'm Barry White and I'm very tight with my mama. And I got every right to go crazy. Them scary nights is what made me. But still I rise to steal the prize. You be ill-advised to try to play me. Ashe.
Wow.
Yeah, you said it, man.
Yes, yes. Thank you so much, Damon. Thank you again so much, Ruthie and Jerry Silva. This was an amazing. I'm so sorry we don't have enough time to go to audience questions because we promised we would end at 1 p.m. California time. So we will be continuing this discussion. We are going to have one more speaker, a young woman, woman who is a recent graduate from Laney College, Laney Community College, where I teach. And she's involved in some abolition work at Laney College, where we have abolished the sheriff from being our security there. She's just gonna say a few things about LRNA, the hosting organization. And we want to make sure that you know that we do have a follow-up study group so we can continue this discussion and try to think about these amazing things that Dr. Gilmore has shared with us. On 7/29 at 6 p.m. Pacific time, 8 p.m. Central time, 9 p.m., we're having a follow-up teach-in slash study group on Ruth Wilson Gilmore's work. On 7/29, if someone's able to put that in the chat, that would be great. And then people can register. You can also find out about it at lerna.org. And without further ado, I'd like to introduce Ms. Alicia Raya. Raya is a graduate. She's a former student body president at Laney College. Go for it.
All right, thank you so much, Dr. King. What an honor it is to be introduced by you. So, and what an honor it was to have witnessed this beautiful conversation that I hope was nurturing to all of you, most of all, encouraging. We are called to this space today because our capacity for love is deep-rooted and strong, right? And to fight for our collective liberation of our people is not only what feels like to me the greatest honor, but also our greatest responsibility. Because we must change everything. And it is clear that the only way that we achieve this new society that the people deserve is if we continue to struggle together, right? And defy these systems of oppression that aim to divide us. So like Dr. King said, my name is Raya. I was born and raised in what is now known as Stockton, California, but is really the unceded land of the Yokut people. I recently graduated from Laney College and where I had the pleasure of meeting my mentor, Dr. King, who gave to me the the honor of knowing this organization, this great organization. So the League of Revolutionaries for a New America, AKA LRNA, is the revolutionary organization whose members curated this event. And the League understands that we need a revolution, right? This is fundamental because we understand that this is the only way we can mitigate the effects of climate change as we know it. It is clear that we no longer have the time to entertain theories of change that don't include total and complete reconstruction of society, right? So this is what the aim that the League does. We aim to educate and organize, and most importantly, introduce a politic rooted in love, class consciousness, and liberation to other revolutionaries struggling across the country on the many different fronts. Because the more that we engage with each other to share ideas and knowledge the way that we have done so beautifully together today, the clearer the process towards a new society will be. So today, LRNA members are from many different backgrounds, many different ages, and I will say that as a young person, it is an honor to organize, decide, and learn from elders and folks who have been doing this work for generations. And it's important for me that I stay grounded in that we all stand on the shoulders of giants, right? And those are the people that we owe our progress and our victories thus far to. So as a LRNA member, one is invested in. It is an organization you can write for, help prep, plan webinars such as this one, or just sharpen your revolutionary theory through studying alongside other members. So LRNA invites you as you are, and again, is an organization that is interested in uniting the scattered revolutionaries across the country around the demands for livable earth and abundance without exploitation, right? So I'll leave us with this. Our great teacher, sister, and comrade, Asata Shakur, who just recently celebrated a birthday, shout out, happy birthday. She says it best so with her quote, it is our duty to fight for our freedom. It is our duty to win. We must love each other and support each other. We have nothing to lose but our change. So with that, that is my pitch. I would love to organize with you again and thank you all for coming again. We are gonna drop a debrief form. It should be sent to all of your emails. And in that debrief form is a question that asks if you would like any LRNA member to like follow up with you and like have a deeper conversation about any of the things that we covered. So go ahead and check yes to that if you want to talk a little bit more. If you want to just read up on some stuff on your own and lean into the wealth of resources that we have on our website, I'm going to drop the website link in the chat. And there's that. So again, wherever you are doing your work, whether it be in your household or interpersonally, interrogating those internalized oppressions or on social media, engaging your family on important political issues, the League of Revolutionaries for a New America is here to learn with you and support you as you grow into your revolutionary potential. So thank you, and I'll pass it to Dr. King.
Thank you so much. It's such an honor to have worked with Raya and to be able to work together as comrades. So thank you everyone for coming today. We really appreciate your participation. Thank you again so much to Dr. Ruth Wilson Gilmore. She's all the way in Portugal. She is spending her time speaking with other revolutionaries and freedom fighters, all of you here. Thank you so much, all of you who came today. We really are so happy that society is moving in the direction that it needs to move in. We hope that you'll join us on August 29th. I really want to thank you, the audience. I want to thank Dr. Gilmore. I want to thank Jerry Silva and Damon Williams, our co-hosts. I want to thank Alicia Rea, who gave our closing comments.
I can't breathe. I can't breathe. I can't breathe. I can't breathe.